All right, welcome everyone. It's fabulous to see you. Jump on in. The water is fine. We're going to get started in just a second. And I am super excited to see everyone. I had a great experience earlier today. I was telling Amanda about this as everyone's coming in. If you haven't checked out the Through the Noise podcast, you should definitely do it, especially in a month when I think my episode's going to be on. But you should check it out in the meantime. These guys are brilliant. They're just really phenomenal. And in preparing to go over there and be on their show, I listened to some episodes to see, and I've been missing out. They have some really good stuff on there, but great, great stuff. Hi, Kylie. Hi, everybody. Why don't you say hi over in the chat portion as you jump in here, and then we'll get started in just a second. Ah, coffee. It's fantastic. All right. So I'm so glad to see everybody. Great to see you. Member Clicks, Rev Crew, Lara. Yeah, coffee. All right. I think that we have enough people signed on here. I'm going to go ahead and run into our intro portion. So welcome to this episode of Association Chat, which is your weekly online discussion for the association community, where we warm ourselves by the virtual fire with topics of the day, welcoming thought leaders and trailblazers alike to join up in this online home for the community. I'm your host, KiKi L'Italien, CEO of Amplified Growth Digital Marketing and host of this weekly chat that's been around since 2009 in one form or another. Uh-oh. And for this week's show, I have to tell you, I am really excited. We have not only an Association Chat supporter who is oftentimes she will join in and participate and lend us her expertise that way, but we have someone who is just, I mean, a fountain of knowledge in her own right. But first, I'm getting ahead of myself. Before I introduce her, let me tell you a little bit more about this week's show. Do you feel a lot of uncertainty around innovation at your association? If so, you're not alone. Most association professionals feel this way. And as a new study reports, association innovation is relatively new. So we're going to explore this. We're going to talk about how some of the most innovative associations have only been doing this for less than 5 years, really focusing on innovation in a conscious way. And they've been exploring this path through trial and error. So what kind of trials? What kind of errors? There's this new Association Industry Innovation Research Study that's sponsored by the National Business Aviation Association and conducted by our guest, Amanda Kaiser. And it's going to help us all to streamline our innovation plans. This is going to help us, hopefully, to make this innovation path far less risky and much more successful. So we're talking to Amanda Kaiser. She is insatiably curious. She asks tons of questions, which I suppose that she should, because she is a qualitative member researcher for the association industry. And she works with associations to build their visions and strategies, their innovation plans and marketing plans based on their members' needs, wants, and worries. She also writes three times a week three times a week for her blog for association professionals at smooththepath.net. So welcome, my friends. Welcome, Amanda. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, KiKi. Thanks for having me on. I appreciate it.
Oh my gosh. Well, it's my honor. I mean, I am really, really excited that you're here because you provide such really fantastic resources on a regular basis for the association industry. And so whether people are following Association Chat on Twitter or whether they're just following your blog, I mean, you get cited, you get referenced a lot. And, on a personal level, I just have enjoyed watching your business grow, you and your business grow over the years. So welcome. And let's get to talking about innovation. I think okay. that When people hear the word innovation, you know, they have these ideas of the light bulb and like all this great stuff. But how is innovation different for associations than it is for-profit companies?
Yeah, that's a really good question. So as you were referencing before, I had the opportunity to work with NBAA, the National Business Aviation Association, in conducting some qualitative research for them. And what we decided to do is we wanted to see how the most innovative associations were innovating. And we went out to 15 of them and talked to them for an hour about how they do what they do and everything from what is your culture like and does it support innovation to what are your processes and the whole nine yards. And as it turns out, association innovation is different than it is at for-profit companies, at least in the way that you see for-profit innovation characterized in the media. So one of those big things is, and you're referencing this early in your introduction, innovation is really new for associations. So my report was the feeder for a sister report that MGI conducted. So I did the qualitative upfront to make sure that we understood the questions we were asking and then the forced choice answers. And then MGI took that and did a quantitative piece of research and they had 344 respondents from the association industry. Wow. And what that sister piece of research said is of all of the respondents, 73% of them only started their innovation plans within the last 5 years, or their focus on innovation in the last 5 years, and more of them more recently, within the last 1 year or so. So I think innovation has been in the sort of zeitgeist of for-profit corporations for a very long time, but for associations, it's relatively new, which means there's a lot of questions about how it is that we do what we do. So I'm thrilled about this report because we can open up that dialogue. The report really, what I think it's best at is showing you the range of what the best associations are doing and giving you some steps that you want to think about for your own association when you're thinking about either starting to innovate or making your innovation plans much more effective. There's one other thing that is really different about for-profit and association innovation, and that's sunsetting. So a lot of for-profit companies are very good at saying, okay, we know if we're going to innovate, we're starting something new. And that means that we have to make time and jettison the old things that are not working. And associations tend to not want to do that. And in fact, in both pieces of research, associations are not good as a rule at sunsetting. We hold tight to what we've got, right? It's very hard to let things go because maybe it'll make some of our members mad. And even if we see that the financials are not so good, it becomes really, really hard to let go. So I would say sunsetting is the other thing, a very big opportunity for many, many associations.
Yeah, those legacy programs and those, I know you see those in every association practically where there are things that are held on to just because politically it's the right thing to do. And I mean like internal politics.
Right.
So it is an interesting situation that you're talking about, and actually really timely because I do think that with the conversation that we're talking about, at least on association chat, and I do hear chatter in the association industry circles where we are talking about things like foresight and we're talking about predictive analytics and really getting into how can we look ahead and make good choices about when things are changing so quickly, about where we're moving our organizations in the future. And so what you're talking about here is, I think, really, really important because people, of course, innovation is part of that.
Right.
So
right.
The study is fascinating, at least to me. And so what are some of the common myths that you run into around innovation that most commonly get associations stuck?
Yeah, so one of the big ones is that innovation has to be big to be innovation. In fact, there was a lot of debate about this. Now, what I did is I had individual one-hour conversations with the respondents, but after combing through all of the transcripts, it seemed to me like they were debating because one person would say, no, innovation has to be truly revolutionary to be innovation. And then somebody else would say, no, no, our innovation is very revolutionary. So let me just define those really quickly. On one hand, you have revolutionary. So it's something that the association has never, ever done before. And we think about those things as being big and risky and scary. On the other end of the continuum is evolutionary. So those are, it's taking what we already do and we're making them better. And what I found through the research is the continuum is very important for us to really think about that range and how we move along the continuum, that both revolutionary and evolutionary are in fact innovation. And what the most innovative associations do is they say, we're going to do both of those things. In fact, we're probably going to continue to do more evolutionary type innovation, the little type of innovation. But as we become more and more innovative, we'll tip the scales. So maybe now we do a little bit more evolutionary stuff and a little more revolutionary stuff and a little less evolutionary stuff. And so there is a danger of only doing evolutionary. There's a danger of only making what you do better, right? Because then you might be making yourself obsolete. At the same time, if you say, we're going to do 10 revolutionary projects this year, you only have so many resources. And so there's a nice balance there.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And those incremental, it's interesting because I definitely believe in incremental changes for the positive, but you just have to make sure that you're working on the right thing, right? And you're not just incrementally changing something that just needs to be completely turned on its head or let
go of. Exactly. Yeah.
So tell me a story. Tell me a story of an association you've talked with, and you don't have to tell us who. When you recognized from the start that their expectations for innovation were out of alignment with reality. This should be fairly easy, by the way.
Yeah. That is an interesting question. So, what I saw, I heard the respondents talk about that a lot. They would talk about how they had to educate or influence people around their expectations of innovation. And so there was a couple of stories that would come out of that. One story was, and this is quite prevalent, that our association is not innovative because innovation requires, it's an art, right? It's an art. And because it's an art, only special people who are kind of endowed with those skills are the right people to do it. When in fact, innovation is a science. There's a step-by-step process in which you can move forward. But there's this feeling that innovation is an art. And that is, it's another one of those myths that gets you stuck. But it's one of those expectations that CEOs and other people of the management team really need to make sure they've debunked before they move forward. Yes, in fact, we are all capable of using this scientific process to move forward, and that it's not all up to luck and heroes. In fact, there was a respondent in the research that actually talked about luck and heroes, that I am continually going back to other people at my association, and I'm constantly saying it's not luck and heroes. That's not the way we operate innovation here.
That's your book. You realize that, right?
That book. There you go.
Luck and Heroes. I love that, actually. That's really catchy, and you really should use it. So fascinating stuff. It's not all about luck and heroes. Mm-hmm. I'm kind of in love with that. All right. Where did these folks go wrong and why? Is it really truly that they just have this misperception about what innovation is? And they just need to be educated on that? Or is it that they don't want to do the work? Or, what is your opinion on that?
Yeah, I think I can kind of turn that on its head when I think about the results of the research. So the way these very highly innovative associations move forward is they focused what they were going to do. They very carefully defined innovation. And they said, this is what innovation is to us, that it's not going to necessarily be this big, giant, scary, risky, awful thing. You know, we're not going to attack our biggest hairy problem. That's not necessarily what innovation is going to be for us. We're going to start here. And so management will put some constraints on it. They talk about how much money they're willing to spend on it, what they were going to focus on, who would work on it, and those kinds of things. And then they started focusing a lot on the culture. So, how do you turn people, how do you take people from being very scared of innovation and very worried about change to being one of the folks that comes with their very best ideas and shares these ideas and is really excited about moving into the future? And how do you bridge that gap? Yeah. And so they're talking a lot about, or they focus in a lot about culture. You know, it's leadership being incredibly transparent. It's leadership communicating a lot. It's rewarding good ideas. They don't reward, but they recognize good ideas. It's constantly championing the cause. It's setting a good example, all of those good things. And then after the culture part or in tandem with the culture part, it's really thinking through, the focus and how are setting our goals and thinking about how we're going to get where we're going to get to and communicating that so it seems less and less scary along the way.
So can we talk a little bit about the research itself? And can you tell us some of the discoveries or surprises that came from the research? Like, what's the biggest surprise that came from the research for you?
You know, the surprise for me, and I'm not sure that NBAA was that surprised by this, but for me, it just blew me over. And that was, I was amazed at how important the CEO was. Not only that the CEO is the driver, but how much effort the CEO needs to put in to make this happen. If you're talking about an association-wide focus on innovation, it's the CEO that really makes that happen. And I guess in my mind, I had kind of thought, if there is somebody, even at the ground floor of the association that does something really innovative, maybe everybody will see that. And then organically, the association will start to be more and more and more and more innovative. But that's not what the research shows. In fact, in my study and also in MGI's sister study, it really shows that it starts with the CEO and the management team. So, and it's not enough for the CEO to say innovation is a priority for me. Mm-hmm. They really have to roll up their sleeves for a sustained period of time. And, they're hiring the right people. They're nurturing the team. They're setting priorities. They're doing all of the organizational things that you'd expect, like setting aside the funds. But they're cheerleaders and they're champions. And there was one respondent that told this really interesting story of he would get up out of his office and every day he would walk around the office and poke his head in people's cubes and just start conversations about this innovative project they were having and how is it going. And he felt like that was one of the single most important ways that he was getting everybody to see, if they were stuck, he would help them take the next step forward, or he'd help them celebrate something that was working really well.
I love hearing that, because I think that I can imagine out there that a CEO would be listening to that and say, okay, more FaceTime. And I certainly worked at places, I worked at associations where there would be that sort of, it's the weekly, the CEO, walks around the floor and says hi to people. And it wasn't like actually, which is fine, but it's better than nothing. But that idea of purposefully going through and asking people about their projects and getting more engaged. I mean, even if you only talk to a couple people every day, you had just a certain amount of time, but you actually dug into some of the neat ideas that they had or their thoughts or just, yeah. you know, a project that they were either struggling with or really excited about and were able to just push it just a little bit further, give that support, that encouragement, you can see how that would really make an impact.
Yes. Know? Yeah. Yeah. Those one-on-one conversations are really fascinating. There was another respondent who talked about recently having taken over the reins of an association. So he came from outside. He was a new CEO to this association. And the first thing he did was schedule 1 or 2 hour long conversations with everybody in the office. And his goal was to genuinely get to know everybody, but his other motive was to learn what was going right, what was going wrong, where were the bright spots, where did people see that things that needed to be fixed, and why hadn't they fixed them yet? And it was really great because through all of those conversations, he was able to, like I do actually in my qualitative research, he looked for the patterns, and it really helped him set the stage for the next year. I love that. It was really fascinating.
I do too. I mean, I think that is an interesting insight that came from the work that you did. I guess if an association wants to put more of an emphasis on innovating, and it sounds like a lot of it does have to do with like culture, like you mentioned it before, but if they're starting to head in that direction, what is something that they should have in place? What should they have in place as they start putting that emphasis there?
Yeah. So interesting that you say culture, because there was, through the research, I uncovered this really interesting kind of dynamic. And that was, of the folks I talked to, there were those who are culture first believers and those who are process first believers. And that was a really interesting thing, because I think they were in some ways trying to get to the same place, ultimately. But the culture first believers really felt like you want to get everybody on board. You want to move, you know, through that gap of I'm afraid of this to I'm a champion of this. And by focusing on the culture, we can do that sort of thing. And most of the people I talked to were the culture first believers. And then there were the process first believers. And the process first believers essentially said, it's not good enough just to talk about innovation. It's not good enough just to try to sit around the table and discuss and make everybody feel good. You have to get into it. You have to start working through a project, and you have to map out the process and get everybody working through those steps. And it's through working through those steps that you you start to change your culture, you know, that you actually see it in action. And so while I believe most associations are on the culture side, I would like to see more associations doing a tandem culture and process at the same time. I think that would probably be more effective, because the result of the culture first folks is what they tended to say is, we got everybody raring to go, you know, in a year or two, people were really excited about innovating, and boom, everybody was off and they were doing their projects and they were innovating, but then we became too unfocused and nothing ended up shipping because, you know, everybody, you know, there was no process. So we, you know, the mandate was to innovate. So everybody was innovating, but not much actually got out the door. And therein lies your process, where you prioritize and you systematize and you assign people and you work through your steps and all of that. So for me, I think that was another big outcome, that associations are very good at the culture piece. I want to see them get better at the process piece.
So how do they do that? I mean, how do they start looking at the process piece of things?
Sure. So what we saw is a lot of processes emerge. One big one was the idea process, you know, mm-hmm. So we have an idea process. Along with our idea process, we might do some sunsetting, or that might be a separate process. So, you know, it's what is next, and then what are we going to leave behind? And then it's the whole new product development process. So among the folks that I talked to, a lot of associations have a new product development process already in place, and that's totally fine to use for your innovation. I'd say more large associations have a product development process in place where the small associations didn't necessarily, because it's all hands on deck, right? But in the research, there is a step-by-step idea process. And, you know, in the step, the idea process, which I think a lot of associations are sort of feeling their way through, comes down to just a couple of steps. And one is really understanding your members' needs and understanding their goals. Because as soon as you find out that your members have a problem, then fantastic. That is a big opportunity for the association. So, you know, first we want them to uncover all of their members' problems and challenges. You can also uncover the bright spots. You know, where in your membership are people already tackling these problems and challenges with great success? And that gives you a lot of information as well that you can share with your members. After you've identified your members' problems, then it's about prioritizing. We've got very limited resources in associations, whether it's money, staff, time, all of those things. And so you want to make sure that you're picking a priority that's on mission for you, but also that is, if solved, your members will find great value in it. So there's about a 5-step process that's outlined in the research, the idea process. And I think that would be really interesting for everybody to look at, because it's a nice process that works whether you're a large association or a small association, and you don't have to invent it from scratch now, because we've got that for you.
So I just wanted to make a note of a few things. One is that while we've been talking over on this side, this is of course, recorded live. And so some of the live comments that we've been getting is just people saying basically saying, amen, you're speaking exactly about what what I have experienced in my own association for some of the things that maybe didn't work when it came to making innovation happen for an association. Another thing is that I see that there's a message coming in that there's a viewer who can't hear everything. So I'm not sure if anyone else out there is experiencing that. But if so, many apologies. And if not, then could a couple of you just write in and let us know loud and clear? Thanks, JP. I appreciate it. So, I wanted to make sure that you guys could hear all of this good stuff, because let me tell you, tech difficulties, not fun. That's the joy of live, as you well know. So I don't know about you guys, but I am getting a lot of value out of what Amanda has been talking about. And so I want to encourage everyone to take advantage of the fact, it's just a reminder that while we're talking, if you have questions that you want me to ask, if you have something that you feel really fired up that you want to talk about, you could even jump on if you wanted to. But let us know, type it into the comments, and let us know what it is that you want to talk about when it comes to the research. Now, talking about the research, where can people find out more about this? Where would you like them to visit to find out more about this work that you've done, and to read maybe a little bit more about it later?
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So if you want right now, you can certainly hop on my site. It's smooththepath.net, and under, I think it's the research tab, you'll find the 2016 Association Industry Innovation Research Study. And you can just go to that landing page, click on the link, and the PDF will open immediately for you. NBAA, so the National Business Aviation Association, they sponsored this, and they thought that they wanted to share it for free to the entire association industry. So you can grab it. You don't even need to leave your email or anything like that.
Wow.
feel free to go ahead and pull that off my site. And Kiki, if you're amenable, we can leave the link on maybe the Facebook association chat group. I can do that afterwards. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. And I don't want to make everyone think that I'm jumping off just yet, or that you're off the hook just yet, Amanda, but I did want to let everybody know where you can find it. So JP writes in, what other sponsored research do you think that we need in the association world?
That is a great question. So JP, I think you're talking about industry research. What kind of industry research do we need right now? And I'm just going to assume that that's what you're asking. I've been giving this a lot of thought because I did this upfront qualitative for an innovation benchmarking research study. And I'm also working with AH Association headquarters right now on a leadership benchmarking study. And I'm really loving this model. For me, it's just it's fascinating to kind of get in and figure out what's going right and what's going wrong in associations, and especially right now, there's a lot of turmoil in associations. I can't think of an association that I have talked to who doesn't say our profession or our industry is going through a revolution. There's multiple technological revolutions. Associations themselves are changing their model. I guess you could say we're going through a revolution as well. So I get the sense that more research is really helpful as we're all trying to feel our way through this very uncertain time. Mm-hmm. One of the things that I've been thinking a lot about, and I'm very interested in, is more research on CEOs. And so through the leadership study that I did and through the innovation study that I did, it just kept pointing to the importance of a high-performing CEO. And I think there might be something there a really interesting piece of research on what is today's CEO, association CEO, look right. like. And you know, maybe the things that an association CEO needed 10 or 20 years ago is very different from what an association CEO needs today, as you know, change is really speeding up. And there's something in there that I'd love to delve into.
I am in love with that. I really hope you do that research. I think that's really, really interesting, especially considering that you found the tremendous impact that a CEO has, that it was even greater than you had thought before. Yeah. When it really comes down to it. So I think that would be absolutely amazing to explore. I do hope you do that. So what about ideas? What about associations coming up with ideas? You talked about the product development process. There's sometimes an idea process. So what is the process that associations are using for ideas that works?
Yeah. It sounded very, when I looked into the data, people were kind of coming at it from different ways. Some associations were very methodical and they would do qualitative in-depth interviews and then they would follow up with a quantitative member survey. Some were looking into their own data. Some of them were using call information. So when members called and wanted to talk to expert staff about something, they would use some of that information, and some of them were they're sitting down with members at their conference for coffee. This discovering problems was happening in all sorts of different ways, and there's two different kinds of problems that they're discovering. One is, what are the problems that nobody's addressing? And then what are the problems that members have with our association, barriers to working with our association? And so depending on what question you're asking would sort of, determine the methodology. It's discovering members' problems. Mm-hmm. Another really interesting part of this is helping those ideas flow. So whether you've uncovered a problem or you think you have a way of solving the problem, usually, especially in smaller small to mid-size associations, a lot of the interface with members is happening with people who might be junior on the staff. And they might have some really great ideas, but it might be very hard for them to get their ideas heard by the people who are going to pull the trigger on a big, and fund an innovation project. And so there was a lot of talk about that associations recognized that this was a problem? And how do you make it so that everybody could get their idea heard regardless of where they are in the hierarchy? Mm-hmm. And I really love that. There was some very interesting ways in which associations were doing that. Some were having an application process. So anybody with an idea had to submit an application, and then all ideas were weighed equally. And I thought that that was a really fabulous way to solve that problem. So you're helping your ideas flow, then you're prioritizing your best. And then after that, once you figure out what we're going to focus on and what we're going to do, say, this year and then next year, then you start dumping everything into your new product development process. And after that, I'd say this was not necessarily an outcome of the research, but it's just a tip for me. If this is something you're new to, select one product you're going to move forward with. You know, don't pile on too much and complicate it. Just try to get through one and then go back and start the process all over again and get really comfortable with the process before doing too many.
I think
that's probably the way to do that.
Man, I tell you what, I totally agree. And I think that it's like that with, so whether somebody's looking at innovation or if they're looking at wanting to do some big marketing push, it's really, you know, choose and go forward with one thing at a time rather than trying to like take on the world all at once, because you know, there's one way that will probably lead you to success at least incrementally. And there's another way that's just surefire. It's not going to work. So,
Although I think we're not built like that as humans. I think we tend to complicate, you know, I think about every website redesign project I've ever worked on in my entire life. It started out simple. And in the end, it ended up being this monstrosity. So I like to throw that in there because it's one of those overlooked things. You know, if you can simplify, you might actually have a chance of completing your project.
I was idealistic, but I was so super idealistic when I started out. And I thought that my ability to stay up late and to do stuff would somehow push, like I could do anything. And so I would definitely bite off way more than I could chew in the beginning. Yeah. And it's something that just, you know, years of realizing that I'm very wrong in that. I've changed that a little bit.
I think all of us type A personalities have hit the wall a couple of times, right?
Where it's like, wow, gosh, I guess if I would have just lowered everybody else's expectations on what to, you know, what would happen here, then I would at this point be succeeding rather than falling way short of what I thought I could do. So, I tell you what, I think that that's absolutely the way to move forward. Tim over here on the side. Hi, Tim. He asked if you've looked at crowdsourcing from members and maybe using tools like IdeaScale or others. I'm not familiar with IdeaScale. So, and you probably, you know all about it and, you know different tools like that, but certainly, I guess you have looked at crowdsourcing from members and things like that before. Do you want to speak to what your process is?
Yeah, so I didn't see that a lot in the research. There was, in this innovation research, there wasn't a lot of that. I think there was a lot of ways that associations are getting their ideas. Some of it's coming from the staff, some of it's coming from the CEO, some of it's coming from the board. Less often were associations going out and doing something more scientific like crowdsourcing or like, any of the member research methodologies, less of them were, but it seemed to me as I was talking to folks, the ones that have been doing it for longer, the associations that were more systematized with their innovation started with a methodology like that, where they were going out and they were really uncovering their members' problems and getting very close to their members and understanding, you know, their challenges, their goals, their needs, and all of that, and then moving from there. But honestly, it seemed like they were all going at it from very different ways. And I'd say that that's the right thing to do. In my own experience, I think that there's a progression. I If you've never done any member research and you don't really have a handle on your data, look at your data first. You'll find a fountain of information there. Maybe after you look at your data and really figure out what you want to do, then maybe you do a survey. And if you're just not getting at the crux of what you want to be doing, then you want to start thinking about some of the qualitative methods, and crowdsourcing could be a good one. But I really, and this is a whole nother, association chat, but one of the things that that I love to work with people on is, methodology is very dependent on the goal you're trying to achieve. Mm-hmm. And very often we match up the wrong methodology with the wrong goal. Or the wrong methodology with the right goal, I guess. I'd like to see us be, as a community, much more thoughtful in, okay, so this is the goal we're trying to achieve, and that goal feeds this sort of methodology, or this kind of methodology feeds that goal.
Yeah, there are so many different things. I love to see when there's a project like this where there are a number of different things that are taken into consideration. Because of the SEO work that I do, sometimes I get brought into these research projects and my piece is just this like little piece of what's happening on the website or something. And it's interesting because I get to hear a little bit about these different types of researcher coming in. And it's always fascinating to see what sort of matches up, where it's like, oh, I could have predicted that based on what I see that's happening on the website.
Yeah.
Versus the stuff where there's some conflicting information coming in, because oftentimes what people think, and it's true, it's what, people don't necessarily know. They think they know, but they don't necessarily know, what they're paying the most attention to, or what they place the most value on. Because if you, for instance, look at, what they purchase more of, or what they click on more, or that kind of thing. This project I'm working on recently is a great example. A lot of times it's different than what they actually would report back,
And oh, interesting.
Yeah. So when they like would put in it all, but it's not like you discount that, because their feelings or their perception is also very important.
Right.
If they were to maybe show up and not see what they consider the most valuable thing to be there, they negatively impact you too. So
yeah, you've uncovered a gap that way.
Yeah, yeah. It's really, really interesting to look at how that kind of thing works. So tell us a little bit more about, you worked with, this association on, them sponsoring the research and them moving forward. You have ideas about some of the research that you'd like to work on maybe in the future. How can people sort of connect with you and start investigating going down that path, and exploring a little more, of their own research or maybe sponsoring research in the future?
Yeah. That would be fabulous. Please reach out. I think probably the best way is to go to my website. So I run a pretty active blog, and I think Kiki said this at the very beginning. I write 3 times a week. And so if you're all interested in anything that I said today, I am going to continue to write articles about the research on innovation. And pretty soon you'll be seeing articles from me about association leadership and the CEO's role with the staff and their role with the board. And so I do that 3 times a week. I also, I do a lot of custom research. So a lot of associations come to me and they say, it's time for us to do our strategic planning. And we think we're ready for some big changes, but we just don't know where to start. And I'll do their qualitative research. And or they'll come to me and they'll say, we want to really get our marketing. We feel like our marketing story is not as strong as it could be. We want to get our marketing story right. And through qualitative research, you can essentially channel the story of your members. Mm-hmm. I talk about all of that on my blog, and it's at smooththepath.net. You can find this research report that we're talking about today, and there's also a contact page, so you can fill out the form or contact me. If you don't like to do that, then you can definitely reach out to me through Twitter. I'm on Twitter all of the time, and my handle is @smooththepath.
And she's an excellent Twitterer. She is. You definitely want to follow Amanda, because @smooththepath, good stuff. And she's definitely on some of my lists that I keep in Twitter. So definitely do that. And with that, I have to say thank you so, so much for joining us this week on Association Chat. You know, every time, I feel like every time I'm saying that we have this excellent episode, and I'm really lucky to know a lot of really smart people. And so we really did have an excellent episode, and I appreciate so much for Amanda, our guest, to lend us her time and expertise on the subject. Upcoming events and association chats, things that you need to know. Next week, not only will we be having an association chat on Election Day, which is also my sister's birthday. Hey to my sister, celebrating her birthday. But associations and changes that are changing the game. So it's really, I'm really trying to find a catchy title for this one, but it's with Shelley Alcorn. And, you know, I had her on not that long ago with Elizabeth Weaver Engel about a white paper that they wrote. But Shelley, let me tell you, she talks a lot about associations in the future. And she is like me in that we don't see a doomsday future for the association industry. We don't see the for-profits necessarily taking over for what associations do. But she is also very realistic, and she has some definite ideas about the things that associations should look at regarding the systemic and the systemic technological and cultural changes that are happening in every sector, and so how associations should address those and consider them when looking at ways to move into the future. So here we talk about innovation and really making it a more practical, like, how do you approach innovation? Next week, I would like it if for any of you who want to continue listening and learning a little bit more about this, looking at ways that you can see what's happening in the culture around you and with technology, and saying, okay, these are the things that we're aware of. This is what it could potentially mean for, you know, our industry or our members' futures. And this is how we can stay on top and really use this innovative process. So I really encourage you to join in. Sorry, I went off on that one. I'm really excited about that one. Okay, and then the week after, we have leading your association through a rebrand. So we're gonna actually go in and switch our focus into something, you know, an association that went through a rebrand and you know, did some interesting things with it. So you're going to be able to hear a little bit more about that on the 15th. I hope you enjoyed this chat as much as I have, and that you learned something that will not only help your association, but will help yourself as well. If you like Association Chat, please consider sharing this chat with your colleagues and give us some love on social media. And as always, if you want to continue the discussion, you can join the Association Chat Facebook group for regular updates on upcoming topics and special guests. So thanks for joining us for this fantastic discussion. Check out www.associationchat.com for a summary of this chat, and you can also watch it again if you want to, or share it with other people, and that'll be posted tomorrow, and we will see you all next week. Thank you so much, Amanda. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
All right.